today with another exciting edition of The New View with Dr. Ray Griffin of Waterford Institute of Technology. Dr. Ray Griffin, you're very welcome to the program.
It's great to be here.
Your area of lecturing mainly focuses in strategic management, and an area that is close to both James and my own heart is Waterford Institute of Technology's development. Having both studied there and currently still studying there, we are very familiar with the deficiencies and the benefits of studying WIT, and we appreciate your expert knowledge in this particular area of a technological university development. So firstly, Ray, could you please tell us a little bit about the history of WIT? Because we started researching for this episode, and I read a report in the Irish Times which stated that WIT downgraded when it became an IT from being an RTC, because it happened at the same time such as areas as Athlone and Sligo. Is this correct or is this incorrect?
Okay, big question, history of WIT, and I know way too much to, like, I could take up your entire podcast with it. I know the place from the skirting boards upwards. Like, it was formed in 1969, and you kind of have to go back to the Ireland that was digging itself out of poverty at the time. It was built by a World Bank loan. Ireland was essentially a third world country at the time. Our universities were tiny, like little strange kind of communities where people learned how to be priests and a few other kind of things. And in many ways, the WIT grew with the Irish economy. And so the raising ourselves out of poverty that happened in the 1960s and 70s, WIT was at the centre of that. It would have started as trades, and the idea was kind of a year after the Leaving Cert. Mm-hmm. In the first few years, it actually did the Leaving Cert. Very soon after that, because there's no university in this region, it started to grow to fill that gap. So unlike the other institutes of technology in Ireland, like, they were all founded in broadly the same time, but now they're really different institutions, almost 50 years later. Mm-hmm. So WIT, 25 years ago, did its first PhD in 1992, was the first graduate in music. It has a broad arts degree, which isn't in most institutes of technology. So it does everything from certificate, diploma, but it's mainly level 8 degrees, which is what gives the big economic transformation in people's lives, and master's and PhD at this stage. It's also, by a long shot, the most significant of the 1969 Institutes of Technology as a research entity. So a lot of people will know TSSG, which is a particular specialism in telecoms, but there's three or four research centres that are very significant in terms of scale. And back in when the transformation from RTC to IoT happened, mm-hmm. WIT was separated out from the herd of RTCs to be made an Institute of Technology. I was really recognising two things. Firstly, that the institution had grown and had moved beyond the RTC vision of kind of essentially creating quite educated technical factory workers. Mm-hmm. There was something much more going on as Ireland was transforming into the knowledge economy. WIT was at the heart of that. And then the second thing is that this region didn't have a university. And at that point in time, the gap started to open up. Like, Waterford as a city, and the Waterford city region of the southeast, was always traditionally wealthy. Mm-hmm. But you could start to see it decline relative to the Corks, the Limericks, and the Galways at this period of time. And it was put down to that it wasn't really converting its labour market into the knowledge economy, and on foot of that, the region was going to lag. A year later, for political reasons, every institute of technology was upgraded. Mm-hmm. And so the specialness that Waterford was conferred in that period of time was gone. It meant that the upgrade was nothing. And then about 5 or 6 years later, WRT management, under enormous pressure from political stakeholders and those in the regional economy, applied for university status. So in 2005, they put together a very significant report applying to be university status, asking for what's called a statutory review, where the government would put in place a panel and analyse whether WIT should mm-hmm. be a university. For 2 years, the government did nothing. And then they convened a report which confirmed that Waterford should be a university, the Port Report. That is obviously politically unacceptable. The same forces that destroyed the IoT upgrade round on national politicians, and we get bounced into what was called the Hunt Report.
Mm-hmm.
The Hunt Report was effectively asking all the universities, would you like to see a university in the southeast? And of course the answer, if you're
a competitor, is going to be no. But who are these forces then?
Well, they're the seven universities, seven university presidents, and they are all the people who have a patronage relationship to a university.
Mm-hmm.
So people feel very, very warm and close to the universities. And in fact, the universities have a very special place in Irish politics because they have a certain amount of control of the Senate.
Yeah.
And it's the NUI universities, it's not even the 1989 universities of UL and DCU.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I would always have the argument that every university in Ireland is brand new. Okay, they might have a backstory,
mm-hmm.
but effectively they were created from the 1980s on. Because universities come into the 1980s as tiny little institutions, and virtually all of their buildings, all of their courses, and their scale and economic impact emerges in the 1980s. So UCD was really created in the 1980s.
Mm-hmm.
So was UCC. UL was created in the 1990s. Maynooth was created in the noughties. So in terms of the regions getting their universities, they only really are relatively new institutions in one sense.
Mm-hmm. So bringing it on to the present day, what is the importance of having a third level, what's the importance for the southeast of having a third level institution in terms of the economy to help it recover?
Yeah, it's very, very significant. It cannot be underplayed how important it is. I'll give you two statistics that crystallize it for me. The first is, if you have a degree, your income expectations in this country are €48,000.
Mm-hmm.
No degree, €23,000. So it's a magic wand that is placed on somebody's head that transforms them from earning €23,000 a year to €49,000 a year.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, €23,000 a year is slightly below the poverty thresholds,
mm-hmm.
in certain senses, and certainly you can't afford housing at that kind of an income range.
No.
So essentially, 2/3 of Irish people are in, of each Leaving Cert cohort are now in the 49k,
mm-hmm.
and 1/3 are left in the 23k cohort. So that's the first statistic. So education, a degree education particularly, is transformative for someone, an individual's life chances. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
The second data point I would indicate at is, in the past, in the southeast, we didn't educate our young people. So we had lower educational attainment rates. Essentially, we didn't send our kids to college because there was no college nearby.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? We don't do that now. Kids in this region go to college, but they leave.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And in the leaving, so this year, for example, there'll be around 5,000 to 6,000 students waiting for the rest of the summer for the Leaving Cert results. And half of them will be gone by October. They will make their lives in Dublin. The €49,000 that they will make will hit the Dublin economy. And for the period of time
mm-hmm.
that they're being educated, their families will broadly fund them.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we all know the cost of going to Dublin is very, very expensive.
Mm-hmm.
So the order, like a bare bones year in university is €12,000.
Mm-hmm.
Average is probably €16,000 to €17,000. Okay? That is after tax income.
Mm-hmm.
That is after-tax income leaving families of the southeast and travelling up the M9 to Dublin, paying Dublin landlord, Dublin universities. So that, at a minimum, is $150 million a year,
mm-hmm.
each year, leaving the southeast just to fund the kids.
So Ray, why are parents opting to put themselves under financial pressure and export money from this economy into an outer economy rather than send their kids to WIT?
Like, I'm a parent myself, to give the kids the best.
Mm.
And is WIT not offering that best?
Okay, so firstly, half of what people need to do or want to do in college is not available here.
Mm.
The A to Z of higher education, archaeology to zoology,
not
so
here.
Half of the stuff is missing. And huge programs like medicine, teacher training,
yeah.
And then lots of specialist programs that are normally in regions would be in Limerick, would be in Galway,
mm-hmm.
they aren't here. So that's half of the problem. And the other kind of part of the problem is a mixture of status anxiety and facilities. Okay, status anxiety is really, people don't know what they're buying for their children when they're buying a degree. Okay, so it's a high trust, high engagement acquisition, like if you think of consumer behavior. So people put a lot of time into researching it, but nonetheless, you just know that if you go to Trinity or you go to Cambridge or you go to Harvard, that everything's going to be okay.
Yeah.
Whereas if you do architecture in WIT, and architecture in WIT is a really strong course, it's, there's a really interesting set of lectures, but you actually have to kind of visit them and see how they work and know, actually, these guys are as good as UCD.
Mm.
They're really interesting. They're taking this very particular perspective on architecture.
Mm.
So there's certain areas where we've won that argument. So accountancy, for example, is, I don't think anybody would walk past WIT to do accounting. Psychology is the same, nursing is the same. But our liberal arts degree, it's 10 years old and it's going up against the 50, 60 year old liberal arts tradition in UCC, and you see the kind of the Harry Potter buildings they have there, and you know, so it takes time to establish it. It certainly does establish, and these are battles we can win. But one of the main ways people determine academic quality is the physical infrastructure of the campus.
Mm.
So in the same way we kind of judge our doctor by the quality of their waiting room. And at the moment the state is investing vast sums of money in the other campuses and nothing in the southeast.
So because it's an IT, as you've said, many of our brightest and most talented young people are leaving this region. Is it an oversimplification to say the only reason they're leaving is because of those letters IT?
No, absolutely not. It's all down to money. So WRT costs around 90 million euros to run. If it was a university in the morning and didn't grow,
mm-hmm.
it would be funded on the base of 130 million. So that's 40 million. And like you look at the new university like Maynooth, which has grown very significantly in the past decade, they're on that higher, the higher income, so higher state income. And you can just see what they're able to do in terms of buildings and the set of engagements they're able to build. Like, I suppose I strongly believe that a lot of what's being spent in universities today is wasted.
Mm-hmm.
There's an awful lot of inefficiency and codswallop going on in universities in terms of how they spend their money.
Mm-hmm.
But ultimately, it does tumble down to student experience in very specific ways.
Mm. So on the 1st of May of this year, you had an interview with KCLR, and you challenged the idea of having small campuses like Wexford, that they don't deliver strong outcomes in certain areas. But given that there are small campuses within WIT, would you include them in this category?
Yeah, I would. Small campuses are a problem in terms of student experience. And it's students have answered this question, it's not the colleges. The colleges will configure themselves in whatever way students want.
Mm.
Wexford's campus of IT Carlow is now 20 years old.
Okay.
And 20 years later, there's less Wexford students going to Wexford's campus than leave the county to go to Waterford. Now, if the students wanted a Wexford campus, if the experience was any good, you would see the CAO points go up and you would see the students' numbers go up. Maynooth collapsed in Carlow. Or sorry, not in Carlow, in Kilkenny.
Mm-hmm.
They spent a decade trying to break into Kilkenny.
Mm-hmm.
And eventually, the student experience was poor. The CAO recruitment had went to taking anybody who completed their Leaving Cert, so it went to ASQ, which is kind of, it just shows the weakness of the market. And they're spending a lot of resources on trying to build a library down there, trying to do computer services, and the student experience is crummy.
Mm.
So like, the reason 13,500 people from our region are studying in UCD and the other universities in this country is because students want these exceptional student experiences that come with large campuses.
Mm-hmm.
So do you believe that students on campuses like College Street and the Granary, that they're lacking student experience?
if you talked to them, like, on the one hand, okay.
Here I am.
Yeah. Okay. Well, if you talk to them, that's definitely the story they tell.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, they feel like second-class citizens. And they kind of go, I don't have access to the library, and I don't have access to the great coffee shop. My coffee shop closes at a certain time.
Mm.
Certainly, I think it can be brilliant for an esprit de corps of a particular professional community. So the architects get a very strong community vibe of being in their own kind of googly
mm-hmm.
type of workplace with beanbags and, you know, so I think something special happens there. In terms of College Street, I would love to keep it. I think it would be a great campus, but it has that Harry Potter vibe. It has the old buildings.
Yeah.
And it even has good quality car parking and facilities.
Do you feel like students are lacking the same education that they might get on the main campus?
Well, I miss them from the main campus.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so these are cool people with interesting views, and they add to the life, the cultural, social life. And so definitely, in the last few years, for example, we've moved the arts degree from College Street up
mm-hmm.
to the main campus. And that it does bring a new dynamic from all the kind of engineers and scientists. And, you know, that's what people are looking for in terms of experience. And as it gets more and more, and you want to create these vibrant societies and kind of cultural programs around the university, the more concentrated you have, the better. And that's definitely the vision for how this plays out.
I want to ask you about the main campus in WIT and the development of a new building there to accommodate students in College Street campus. Do you believe that that will add to their development as students?
No, because that new building, I suspect, will never be built. call me cynical, but I've seen it being announced 8 or 9 times at this stage. And I've seen the fence rust.
Yeah.
in that period of time. I walk past it several times a day. That building was announced in 2008, 2009, 2011. It was cancelled in 2013. It was re-announced in 2015. It was announced twice in 2016. So
do you think this could be the time, considering the economy is kind of picking up?
It's going to take 4 years to build that building.
Mm-hmm.
This is independent of the economy, because we built university buildings throughout the recession.
Okay.
So since 2011 to 2016, as a society, we spent 1.6 billion euros on university buildings. We spent zero on IoT buildings. Zero.
Mm.
So like, the 7 universities have on average got 200 to 300 million. And the entire WIT campus as it stands costs 150 million. So this is a decision by the state not to invest in this region. It's not like they don't have money or they're being thrifty about it. They're investing in the least efficient institutions in the system,
mm-hmm.
strategically to deprive this region of higher education capacity and its young people.
WIT, only about a decade ago, was the top IT in the country. And as I said to you, there seems to be a huge push towards funding of IT Carlow at the moment. Do you think that that's a move to force WIT's hand into merging with IT Carlow?
I don't think it's anything to do with IT Carlow. We are being schooled as an academic community. The community in WIT responded to the stakeholders and applied for university status in 2005. And ever since then, it's very hard not to think that they're trying to put us back in our box and send us down market and send us back into the past. For a number of years, the senior management in WIT were in tremendous difficulty. Leader after leader after leader after leader, until I count up to 5, found their careers over.
Yeah.
In very difficult circumstances. I've never seen anything like it in the state.
Mm.
Like, so it's very hard not to argue that the powers that be within Dublin decided to teach the Southeast a lesson.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we're now, you know, 12 years down the road of this lesson teaching, and the higher education platform in the Southeast has not progressed as it should have. It has been thwarted at every stage. Every other region has seen the type of developments that we haven't seen.
Mm-hmm.
And this has an enormous political, social, cultural cost to the people in this region.
A final question before we move on to the future of WIT is, I want to ask you, do you believe that there's a mistrust in WIT between staff and management?
The last few years have been really difficult, okay? And what academics do when there's no resources and things aren't being resourced properly is they focus on the relationship with their students. That's what you can control. And I don't know any of my colleagues in WIT that don't do everything they can for their students, and that's their primary concern. Certainly, in the face of the hardship that continues in to be handed down from Dublin to the management, I do think a lot of colleagues have, it took them a long time to see that this isn't their managers and this is actually a national strategy move against us. I kind of would agree with you.
Mm. So earlier this year you mentioned in an interview with Dermot Keyes of the Munster Express that WIT should be on a level playing field with places like UF. So is it fair to assume that you're seeking a technological university for the Southeast?
No, it isn't, because I saw the technological university bill go through.
Mm-hmm.
And I monitored it very closely. I've read the 100 pages of that document, and they took everything we might want out of it. It actually would have been really hard for WIT management if they put a small amount of money on the table and a small bit of progress.
Mm-hmm.
But to my mind, they've overplayed their hand. The technological university is a straitjacket.
Mm.
It would weaken the Southeast economically and socially. And broadly, I'm of the view that we probably should leave it pass. It's a great solution for Dublin.
Mm.
It cleans up the mess that is Blanchardstown, Tallaght, and DIT.
Mm-hmm.
It's a good solution for CIT and Tralee in the sense that there's a very strong, growing UCC that is never going to allow CIT to emerge.
Mm-hmm.
So CIT needs to be something different.
Mm-hmm.
LIT has already decided it's going to be something different. As it went multi-campus, it's 5 satellite campuses. GMIT is doing something similar. So all of those, it's designed for the other IOTs, but it is not designed for the Southeast, which is unique in that it is the only region in the country without a university.
So you think we'd be better off remaining Institute of Technology then?
I think at some stage the politics of this country will have to solve the economic and social problems of the Southeast. It will be done through higher education. You know, and to be honest, like, I care a lot about WIT, but I care much more about what WIT does for our community.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I want done.
Mm-hmm.
And they need to find a way of doing that. I'd be surprised if it can be done without bringing WIT along. I think WIT is going to be part of that solution. What's happening at the moment is WIT management and WIT academics are standing their ground,
mm-hmm.
saying we're not going to be bought off by a fake university that takes us a long time to twig, that there's nothing in it. And it just won't appear in the unemployment numbers,
mm-hmm.
and the job quality numbers, and the student retention between leaving cert and post-primary.
One question is, though, that if these, I haven't read the full act, I haven't read the full drafting
it's
of
hard
it.
Work.
I have a legal background,
yeah.
but I have not read it.
Yeah.
Would these technological universities be provided with equal financing to the current universities? So you said earlier that they would receive 120 million euros and the current IOTs are only financed to the tune of 80 million euros.
Oh, well, that's WIT. Each one is on a different
Each
project.
One. Would WIT's financing increase if they sign up to the terms?
No. The technological university is a restatement of the IOT sector.
Mm-hmm.
That this region was conned into thinking it was getting something and it didn't get something.
Mm-hmm.
It's a restatement of the RTC network. So it's a new type of kind of Berlin Wall apartheid. There's two types of students in this country,
mm.
a university, and there's technological university of IOTs. And the fact of them, we can see it most clearly in the Ireland 2040 strategy. So the brand new plan is they're going to spend 2.2 billion on new buildings in universities and IOTs over the next 5 years. 2 billion is going to the 7 universities. 200 million is going to the 13 IOTs, or the new technological university.
Mm.
So there's absolutely no proposal. The reason you know this is the universities would be going bananas.
Yeah.
If there was actually any threat to them.
Mm-hmm.
And they're not.
So what's the actual difference between a technological university and a university, or is there any difference?
Imagine if I went home to my wife and said, we're technically married, rather than married.
So they'll be technically a university.
No, okay, it is to be fought for. But as the Act is written, it is none of the freedoms, none of the powers, none of the spirit and atmosphere and ethos of a university. And most importantly, it is none of the resources.
Mm.
So unless they're going to transform the resources going into this region in higher education, don't expect them to transform the outcomes.
And there are a lot of rumors out there, and I just want to put it straight to you because you can clarify whether these are true or not. Is it true that places like Sligo and Mayo would be first in the pecking order to receive TU status than Waterford?
Well, Dublin has had its panel and is going to get it in September, I would assume. We expect Tralee and Cork to go through reasonably quickly. The South East is not going to be solved because the, as I said earlier, the proposal just is not sensible.
Mm.
The people leading higher education in the Southeast and the people around this conversation are just saying, this isn't the fix. If this is the once in a generation opportunity to fix this problem, this is not it. So there's a feeling that until they come forward with something sensible, that we shouldn't progress because people will think something is happening when it isn't.
But do you think it'll go ahead regardless of the views of the staff of IT Carlow and WIT?
Only as an act of violence, and I really think that they've been down that road before, and I think they're unlikely to press that button. I think the best we can hope for, and this is kind of what I hope is happening, is that the Dublin consortium move forward, the Cork Kerry consortium move forward, and then a different solution is found for the South East, one that will deliver the kind of economic and social transformation we need.
You tweeted on May 3rd that a merger of IT Carlow and WIT is unlikely to solve anything. So what is the solution that we require in Waterford?
What we need is a platform capable of delivering universal university services. So we need a UCC, a UL, an NUIG. We need what the other regions have. The role model for us is UL, because UL was created in 1989. And about 10 years later, you can start to see it harness up the Midwest economy.
Mm-hmm.
The Midwest didn't really participate in the recession because the university started to really perform for it. So you may recall Dell went, and everybody was going, oh my gosh, Dell is going. But very quickly, unemployment rates dropped below the national average and job quality rates rose. To a certain extent, Dell going released talent into the labour market that was mopped up at higher price points. So you can see that's basically what we need. So until we have a med school, until we have archaeology to zoology, teacher training within the region, young people will leave, they will make their lives outside the region, and this region will be held back. What has to emerge is a competitive platform, and I'm not against a merger with Carlow, as long as what emerges is a competitive platform capable of going after the existing universities, go toe-to-toe with them, and keep the young people from this region in the region, contributing to the economy and society.
Is it also down to successive failures of our political representatives in Waterford?
Yeah, although I wouldn't be too tough on them. I think we've had very limited political patronage here, and the political heavyweights we've had from the region have really failed to deliver. So when you think of our senior ministers, in this political cycle, we've had nobody from the Southeast achieve cabinet status. That is just deadly dangerous. Especially like today, Simon Coveney announces 30 million to Cork Port. It's just day after day, it's 10, 15, 20, 30 million here, there, and everywhere, apart from here. So the longer this government continues in office, like every day it's costing us. In the previous cycle, we did have two very senior political representatives. They, I call them footpath politicians because they fixed footpaths in front of their front door. They really failed to do the strategic things that need to be done. So they didn't stabilise the regional healthcare system. They didn't do the business that needed to be done on higher education. They didn't do anything on enterprise development, IDEA, Enterprise Ireland, SFI, Science Foundation Ireland. So they did nothing strategic, and I just think the big boys brought them up.
I read a column that you wrote in the Irish Times where you refer to the abolition of ITs as a senseless act of violence. You go on to mention the Hunt Report and how the TU Act itself envisages putting the ITs back into a 1960s working class box. Is this a sensationalization of the facts?
No.
Is it fear-mongering?
No. The Hunt Report was written by the university presidents.
Mm-hmm.
And it was their vision for the IOTs. Okay? And that's all very well if you're in a Cork or Dublin, where you have universities, but this is a region without a university. It just has an IOT. We were talking about earlier about the Act and 100 pages long. One of the things it does is the existing legislative basis for the RTC, IOT, so WITs, the laws that are written for WIT, allow a tremendous freedom. And it cannot be stopped by forces outside. So the Minister for Education can't stop WIT, and our competitors can't. Under the TU Act, we can be stopped. So for example, WIT was awarded its first PhD in 1992. It did its first degree in 1985. And these were first in the IoT RTC sectors. And there was kind of going, like in Dublin, they were askance that we were doing this.
Mm.
And they tried to stop us, and they realized there's no law that can stop it. So the original document that led to the creation of WIT, called the Mulcahy Report, says really beautifully, there should be no artificial impediments to the growth of this institution. Which is kind of like what you'd say to your kids, that you're not going to stop them artificially from developing or growing any curiosity they have. So it's a great principle of education, is that you don't thwart somebody's evolution or an institution's evolution. Well, the TU Act does that. It has rules around how its governing body is organised and what it can teach and how it can teach. And it's a really horrible vision for education that's entirely built around the economy, so that there's no kind of actual social or cultural growth other than getting a good job, around enterprise and entrepreneurship, which these are important things, but they're not all that education is about. If you ask any lecturer, are they just about getting people employable, they'd be appalled at that suggestion.
So when we may become a technological university, maybe in the near or far future, lecturers will be required to do a certain amount of research hours or write journal articles. Can you honestly say that your colleagues and maybe some trade union representatives would be supportive of that? Do you think they would undertake that work?
Like hand on heart, absolutely. WIT has 500 lecturers, okay? So of them, around 200 have doctorates, okay? And 200 of them have made enormous personal sacrifices to create a university in the Southeast. So most of them were appointed, so they were sitting lecturers, and they decided, I need to upgrade myself to be part of the knowledge economy in this region. Okay, so I think there's 200 people who have gone to enormous efforts as part of that agenda. And I think other people, and some subject areas don't lend itself to doctorate education, and it's a little slower in development. Some schools have a different culture or ethos, and they're focused on professional practice. But this is the exact same with the Irish universities. So 20 years ago, there was no research going on in most of the Irish universities. And WIT has shown it can do big European projects, it can do PhD education, its academic can write in 4-star journals. I think a lot of the 200 staff would be thrilled to have research recognised in their contracts, because most of them are doing their teaching and then their research, and so their work-life balance is really badly affected. So like one of the things I start tweeting big time in June, because everybody asks me, oh, you must be on your holidays. Like, I've missed out on the glory days of this profession where horse and cart would turn up to Trinity and all the academics would clear off for 3 months. Like we work right through the summer. I'll be traveling for most of the rest of this month and next month at conferences, and then I'll take 3 or 4 weeks off. It's a great holiday to have in any profession. But it's not the 8 or 12 weeks that people think happens. So I think it would be great if the contracts we have supported the work we do. The bigger thing is, and I go back to a question you asked earlier, which was around academics' relationship with WRT. Most academics' relationship is with their students and with the community they serve, not with the institution. And it will involve sacrifice, it will involve transformation, but the prize is this region gets to keep its young people. And I don't think anybody isn't part of that mission.
And do you think that many of the students know what's in for them or ahead of them if we become a technological university? Do you think students would support it if they found out what was actually going to happen? That not much would actually change, albeit the moment?
Yeah, I think student politics is in a particularly weak period of time.
Yeah, it is.
A lot of students have a lot of project work, then they have probably work outside of college. We're now quite a few years into students having very significant fees by another name. And so the space in a student's life, and this is a problem in all the universities, has withered down to, you know, and often commuting affects that as well.
Yeah.
So the cultural life in the college has dropped, and certainly the political life in it. And really, that's, hand on heart, I think most students would think this is a problem for the next generation of students.
Yeah. Definitely. You know, one of the things about WIT though, which I think we have understated perhaps, which I'm sure you believe it, I'm sure we all believe it, is that despite being being an IT, despite underfunding, we're still very good at what we do in WIT. And perhaps we can become a university someday, but it may be required for there to be some reforms within WIT for that to happen. The Department of Education, of course, commissioned a report into the relationship between WIT and individual companies. And that received a hell of a lot of backlash at the time, particularly the campus services company, and question marks over the ownership of that company itself. Aside from that, where do you believe, as a professional who works in WIT, where do you believe reforms are required?
Okay, I'd start by taking on one of the bases of your question. WIT is an excellent university already, in my mind. The marketplace has answered this. Our graduates are treated the same as the graduates from universities. They're certainly not discriminated in their recruitment processes and the incomes that they get and where they go to in their organisation. So the labour market has answered the excellence question. And I also think, like, say, for example, last year I brought in €300,000 of research funding. That was competitively won funding against other academics. And, you know, and my colleagues are doing that day in, day out. So toe-to-toe we go with the universities day in, day out. And, you know, they have their own problems. And I think we do remarkably well and are as competitive. And the courses and the core education content of them is comparable. The governance difficulties WIT has had, I see as a pattern of bullying that came from a university application. Given the scale of everything that went at, like WIT is the most examined higher education institution in the country, which is remarkable given we know the amount of money going in the door is a lot less than everywhere else.
Yeah.
And the outcomes coming out the door are much higher than everywhere else.
Mm-hmm.
So you wonder what the hell they're doing. I think it's incredibly unfair to expect WIT to have the corporate governance standards of much better resourced institutions.
Mm-hmm.
Every time we hire a lawyer to write a contract, we're not spending money on student buildings, student services, Wi-Fi, library opening times, these things that really make a difference. So corporate governance clearly isn't a nice to have, but we have to be minimalist and thrifty and ruthless on how we acquire it. So like our most recent difficulty is bizarre because we had this campus company set up that was remarkably valuable and created loads of jobs within the region and then gets investigated. And yeah, the corporate governance of how we never thought we were going to have a €60-80 million spin out company.
Mm-hmm.
And we certainly didn't have procedures and practices in place for it. But they grab at everything in Dublin to put us back in our box.
Mm-hmm.
And I see that as just a pattern of bullying myself. I don't see it as a decent, honest oversight with clean hands.
And
it's my own sense.
And but to get to that part, or it maybe it's not applicable, but do you think that there are any areas where WIT needs to reform?
Absolutely. Like, we need a huge amount of capital investment. You know, our building stock is quite old.
Mm-hmm.
It's overutilized.
Mm-hmm.
So our timetabling is run at near total. You can't organize a meeting in the place because you can't get a room.
Yeah.
Car parking and Wi-Fi and library. Name one resource that actually is adequate, you know, for our purposes. So that's a huge area of reform.
Well, I mean personally, sorry to cut across. I mean personally, I study in the Tourism and Leisure Building, and I mean it's top class facility, and there's even I think more classrooms than we need. But
mm-hmm.
the facilities like the kitchens down there and the trainer restaurant, I mean it is top class. So not everything is
that's our youngest and best building, interesting enough, funded
yeah.
by CERT, which is the tourism our board Fáilte, Tourism Ireland, rather than the Department of Education.
Okay.
You have to go 20 years back before we had a teaching building funded
yeah,
by
I see what you mean,
the
mm-hmm.
Department of Education. But you're right, we do have, you know,
yeah.
we do have good resources in certain places, and you know, it's certainly adequate for what we're doing, but they're not as competitive as they should be,
yeah.
and
mm-hmm.
not certainly not attractive and handsome, and you know, I'd love to have. So, for example, in 2012, we cancelled the School of Business building. Well, we didn't cancel it; it was cancelled by the Department of Education.
Mm-hmm.
That building should be open now, and nobody's actually saying, "Well, there's going to be a huge cost to us not having that facility."
Yeah,
you know, and okay, the building I think costs €14 million. Now UCC are spending €100 million on their School of Business, and Trinity are spending €90 million on their.
Drop into water compared to.
Yeah, well, there's not a lot of Italian marble in what we were planning to build, but it would have been transformative for business education in the southeast.
Mm.
And so we definitely need that reform. We will need HR reform, and so ultimately we'll have to move to large lecture theatre teaching.
Yes.
With. And be very thoughtful in how we transition to that, so we bring learners along. I think we'll also need new type of employment contracts that are research-led
mm-hmm.
and engagement-led, although I think they'd actually be more a recognition of what most people are doing.
Already,
because our employment contracts aren't fit for purpose. I think we'd need a much more flexible employment system like they have in the universities.
Mm.
We definitely need to handle how is a researcher's career path supported. There would be, at the moment we're dramatically undermanaged, so the ratio of lecturing staff to administrators is 7 lecturers to 1
mm.
administrator,
mm.
whereas in the university sector it's closer to 2 administrators for each lecturer.
Wow.
Okay, so that, you know, that's very transformative. But it's back to the way WIT has grown to put everything on the table for students
mm.
and have very little, you know, kind of cushy stuff.
And it's important we maintain that, I guess, too.
Well, it's a transitional thing. It's also a transitional thing that UL and DCU and Maynooth, the 3 brand new universities that were created in the last 20, 25 years, have gone through.
Mm.
My final question for you before I hand over to James is this. You know, Ray, given the exorbitant amount of issues in WIT, do you think you and your colleagues are still happy working there?
Of course we are.
Really? I mean, there seem to be so many issues. How do you stay happy?
Oh, well, it's this kind of conversation I'm having is a very, very small part of what I do. My main work is with my students. So at the moment, I have 5 PhD students. Each one of them is doing amazing world-class research at the cutting edge of the discipline I teach in. So like, I always think colleges are like theme parks of young people. They're just full of, you know, creative, interesting, exciting people to be around. People feed off their teaching and research. So.
Mm.
Oh no, it's a great job. The fight is great as well.
It's worth the fight.
Oh, absolutely. You know, and you know, there's a lot of academics in here. So today is the 20th of June and my contract says that I'm officially on holidays. Well, I walked out of the place at lunchtime and, you know, I was asking Donna where I go for lunch and they were all too busy.
Mm.
You know, the work is too much,
yeah.
It's too interesting. You know, and you'll see next week and the following week the place will be crowded with academics. We get it back,
mm.
We get to do our research, write our papers, travel. No, it's a brilliant life.
Yeah. I think we covered everything. I just want to thank O'Shea's Hotel for being so accommodating to
mm-hmm.
the podcast. And thanks to Dr. Ray Griffin for coming on. I mean, it was an extremely insightful interview. And I'm sure one that both with staff and students would like to listen to because it affects all of our futures here in this room.
Absolutely.
So, Dr. Ray Griffin, thanks very much for coming on.
Thank you.
Cheers.